I'll do absolutely anything to be on TV.
Welcome to the 1990s, seen as the decade where Britannia's finally cool, where post-pub telly dips its pinky into the grossest of stunts. Oh. Where primetime entertainment has us all enjoying chimps dressed as Nazis. Where puppet stars look off their beaks performing to drug-influenced dance music.
Oh my God!
Where we can once again laugh at retro stereotypes because now they're ironic. Where the million-pound drop means something very different.
It has actually passed a stall.
I've never had to check a lavatory pan for some shit.
And where discussion shows allow actors to really make their point.
Why should you forgive yourself because a boy falls before you?
Don't understand.
All this was broadcast on TV and we watched it. Had we all gone out of our heads? Or was it all right in the 90s?
Whoa! Bye-bye.
As the 90s unfolded, the whole world started buying into brand Britain. We were blazing new trails in art, fashion, music, film, football, even politics. Yes, tonight we're looking at Cool Britannia. And by that we mean cutting-edge rap.
People die, family too, so stop smoking or next it's you.
Flaunting your old chap. And Mrs. Norton in a flap.
I'm ringing to complain about the totally excessive and over-the-top coverage of the release of Nelson Mandela.
Just how cool was the Britannia we really lived in? And how cool was the TV we were watching? Well, we're showing vintage programmes to the people who made them, some who were watching.
This is changing the way I think of the 90s.
Absolutely.
And some who were just too young to remember.
Gosh.
Bloody hell.
Should we look back with a sense of outrage?
This was on the telly!
What the hell?
Or a sense of humour?
Billy licked his way through this old man's flaky scalp.
I'm taking the earpiece out, I'm taking the...
Guys!
The dandruff was off the menu this series.
Can I use this? Okay, show it again.
Telly, in bold, self-assured Cool Britannia, was, in three words, outrageous. And in the beginning was...
The word.
For 5 years, the word thrived on outrage, most famously with the hopefuls, everyday people who would endure any degradation just to get on telly. And every Friday night at 11, nearly 2 million of us rushed home from the pub to watch them.
Meet Carol from Halifax. Her brush with stardom involves a bath full of fresh horse manure and cow's urine.
Whoa, man.
Oh, no.
Just keep the snorkel vertical.
It's just horrible.
Yeah, you're right.
Meet Simon Ewan, an 18-year-old business studies student from London who wants to be an entrepreneur. To give him a taste of stardom, we served him up a bowl of toenails fresh from the chiropodist and garnished it with a few corns and verrucas. Bon appetit, Simon.
Slightly retching. Now, I've got a limit. I've found my limit.
That's what I wanted.
I'd do anything to be on TV.
All the viral videos that grip us and disgust us and entertain us secretly at work on YouTube are all these kind of things. So in 1 hour-long show, you basically had the future of all media.
There was a lot of that sort of behaviour going on. It was sort of, can you be madder than me?
This, I'm mad, me, mentality was part and parcel of a movement that would come to dominate the decade's telly. In the 1990 World Cup, England footballer Paul Gascoigne famously bared his emotions before millions. This good-humoured crisp advert had fun making light of this, and we all fell for this new, sensitive man, in tune with his feeling. Of course, when he released his pop records, we soon realised that Gazza could be just as boorish as the rest of them.
Oh, man.
This one, charting at 31, showed us the real Gazza in all his bare-chested, burping glory.
Does seem a bit camp.
Bit camp? Surely not.
I mean, was this specifically for gay people to listen to?
Yeah.
Wayne Rooney would not release a single now, would he? Football, this wouldn't be the career path anymore. He's getting his body out a lot.
Oh, it's so, like, macho that it really just goes back around again. Crikey, Gazza.
Football, boozing and lariness were back in vogue. The right-on, equality-conscious new man of the late 80s gave way to the resurgence of the bloke. The new lad culture had arrived.
The new man and the lad are kind of Jekyll and Hyde figures, aren't they? Both of them rather unreasonable and unrealistic representations of what men are like.
Gazza became the poster boy for hot new lads mags like Loaded and FHM. And inevitably, shows like BBC Two's Lad-tastic Fantasy Football League followed. Badil and Skinner merged rowdy flatmate humour with obsessive fandom.
We would be doing jokes and comedy and cultural references about football and pornography. Stuff like that. In a way that, although it would be self-aware about what you could and couldn't say or what you were supposed to not be able to say, it would still say those things.
The lads had their own sitcom, Men Behaving Badly.
Frankly, Tony, you don't turn down a 17-year-old girl guide with buttocks like a racehorse.
That was the thing about this sort of laddishness on Men Behaving Badly. You were a bit of a bloke, but you were also a bit pathetic. But that was quite funny.
We're never quite sure at one moment whether we're laughing with them or at them, which we mostly are with the women, and we're on their sides because these guys are useless.
You were obnoxious, arrogant and self-obsessed.
So? I suppose you think it's easy being a man in the 90s.
I don't know. Should we ask one?
It's a quest. It's a quest to find where masculinity should settle down.
The lads even had their own TV night out, with 2 million tuning into Chris Evans' chat and music show, TFI Friday. Just like any stag do, the late repeat had team members stripping their kit off and showing their helmets to total strangers.
In the 90s, was everyone drunk the whole time? They must have just been drunk.
There is absolutely no way I'd get naked on television. No, it's not okay. Like, if you want to see that, message me on Grindr like a normal person.
If someone walked onto a chat show or into a similar TV show nowadays, it would, and they were naked, it would be shocking. People would go, oh, my God, what's going on? However, people are meant to be more, I don't know,
speechless? The show also had interviews straight from the pages of the lads' mags, like Page 3 star Kathy Lloyd.
I mean, come on, this is stirring stuff, isn't it, TFI?
See, when is the Trail for Men going to start again?
I don't know, I just want to meet someone nice, suitable. I mean, I'm just going out. If I fall upon one, then cool.
I can remember watching that as a kid and thinking, this is so cool, Evans is the man, he's living the dream, and obviously now in hindsight you kind of go,
yeah,
what a ledge.
With lad culture dominating the media, women fought back with girl power. Anything the lads could do, the ladettes could do louder and larrier. Is that Ulrika Johnson downing a pint? And at 11 p.m. on Friday nights, they had their very own version of Women's Hour, Channel 4's The Girly Show, as garish and as raucous as this title sequence suggests.
They'd put me going like that and us being real ladettes, just coming out of a male strip bar at 6 o'clock in the morning, having downed about 8 pints.
I've been thinking about getting a tattoo, but I'm a bit queasy about needles.
Do it! Go for it!
Do it! And get the beast as well!
And each week, Sarah Cox, the woman who now presents a pottery show, laid into one hapless man with barely restrained brio.
Pot poser, whose cheesy grins and perfect pecs make him look like every neighbour's bin boy rolled into one. It's Peter Andre.
Nobody does it as well as her, do they, really?
You think of all the people who might be brought to book for their misogyny. Peter Andre doesn't seem like public enemy number one.
You get your six-pack out more often than Gazza on a bender, and your pop flops have a vomit stain on the chin of the charts.
Sarah Cox would sashay off into her little dressing room and write a most fantastic wanker of the week. And it just took my breath away every time.
Well, you've been... stuffed by the girlies, because Peter Andre, you are tonight wanker of the week.
Yeah! I loved what she used to do with her, you know, all that. No, she didn't do that, did she? I just added that in. Oh, well.
First thing we have is the tabletop seductive dancing competition.
Back at the Word, Katie Puckrick, the girly show's spiritual sister, presented a wild child contest, judged by Piers Morgan and Peter Stringfellow.
And continuing the cavalcade of stars, we have Freya. Freya, young, free and single. She was caught by her teacher smoking pot at the innocent age of 15.
The only thing that makes this awkward is the presence of those two sleazy men on stage.
Just 15 years old, and she's already been expelled from school three times.
They've all been expelled from school three times.
Yeah, it's because The Word was filmed during the day in a week. So only people who've been expelled who could actually attend.
We test the skill that all wild children must possess, which is the ability to change quickly from their party clothes into their school uniforms.
I'm riveted by this. Like, I don't feel like I've ever seen this in my entire life.
Familiar with the task. So,
I am...
This is an exercise in...
Aghast and...
You've got to have the knack for peeling in confined spaces.
Glued.
Born with. There'll be a few exploded zippers and seams after tonight.
It feels bad. I don't feel good at the moment because I loved the 90s and this is changing the way I think of the 90s.
Absolutely.
We want our judges to make the final decision because extra points should go for groping, fondling and dancing and changing.
We don't want anyone with any brain to win this, so we've had a long think about this.
I mean...
Which proves one thing. Piers Morgan has actually got more likeable as the years go on.
The interesting thing about watching that clip is that it's sort of simultaneously celebrating and damning humanity.
Even early on Saturday evenings, ITV was swarmed by lads and ladettes. 15 years before Take Me Out, there was Man Oh Man.
Welcome back to this cardboard jungle clearing we call Man Oh Man. We're frankly with these Amazons in our audience tonight.
These guys arrived so full of themselves, and within minutes they were just... reduced to rubble.
OK, girls, two must go. Come and get them!
The female audience voted which unlucky lad would get dunked by a man-o-man model.
Oh, the man-o-man dancers, yes. The audience was 400 women, all completely pissed before they arrived. In the pool, it's... They were terrifying, weren't they?
And when the ladettes got home from all that partying, they needed something to watch.
This was on the telly! Yay!
And now, Elvis, the time has come. Well, I want you...
Shown very late on Fridays, the student quiz Naked Elvis had an Elvis impersonator stripping.
Oh, my! That...
This is the most tragic show I've ever seen.
One of the things we lack these days is sort of pub hours where people do stumble back into their homes up past 11, 12 o'clock and need nonsense.
Weigh 12 stone.
The lads and ladettes became so dominant in the 90s that even educational telly had to be bright, loud and in your face. So when Channel 4 allocated a 9 p.m. Thursday slot to encouraging healthy lifestyles, it was done as a game show, including a British TV first.
Let's play Who Gives a Shit?
No.
As you can see here, we have three toilet cubicles.
And what we would like you to do is a poo.
These men are being asked to defecate live.
And we have, for you to do a poo, £1,000! £1,000! Now, we're going to flush the money, £100 by £100, until one of you passes a motion.
I don't believe this really happened, at least I don't want to.
Press the button. The siren will go off above your cubicle and we will know that someone has passed a motion. The winner gets all of the money that's left. This game is not about being number one, it's all about number twos. On your marks, get set, go!
She's describing it with the exact same relish that she now applies to the £1 million drop.
So if this programme's come as a bit of a shock to you...
That alarm means that someone has done it.
Is that for real? Let's go and check out the scores on the cubicle doors. It's the middle one. I do believe that that is Francis. Francis, would you like to come out, please?
Well done, Francis.
I've got to go and check that he has actually passed. Thank you. I'm glad you can sympathise with me, because this is something I've been dreading.
I've done some terrible things in my career, some really awful things, but I've never had to check a lavatory pan for some shit.
Yes, I can confirm... God, Francis. He has actually passed a stall. Francis, do you know what that means?
No.
That means you get this lovely gold-painted loo brush holder, the Drop Dead Show loo brush holder, and... £800!
I thought you said 1,000. Maybe his poo wasn't big enough. If someone on Embarrassing Body saw this, they'd be absolutely good. They'd just hand the poo in for free. I mean, you could have did it on here with Davina and won a gold toilet brush and 800 quid.
Still to come.
I suppose it is true to say that whenever I look at any member of the female sex, I find myself wondering what it would be as an experience to see them undressed.
Humphrey was creeping me out big time.
Welcome back to the 90s. At the 1993 Conservative Party conference, John Major had a dream. A tidy, polite dream.
Time to get back to basics.
Back to basics? Well, what could be more basic than this new spin on a great old family favourite?
Next question. What was de Dion Bouton famed for inventing?
He looks like a pervy old guy, straight away.
Independent rear suspension.
No, incorrect. It was semi-independent rear suspension.
This is awesome. Are they just going to strip?
Oh, please. Gosh. So you get it wrong and you have to take off a bit. Oh. It's just mastermind for perverts.
The end of another strip master brain, and I can tell you that our winner with 11 points is Sheila Shelley. Sheila will now go on to our end of series draw, in which you could win her very own live TV T-shirt.
Quite a lot of time for this. This is really good TV.
Strip Master Brain was one salacious tidbit on Britain's first 24-hour cable channel made with the lads in mind. Live TV. The channel was the subject of a frenzied BBC documentary following station bosses Janet Street Porter and Kelvin McKenzie. This revealing insight into backstage troubles was filmed in the 6 months before Street Porter left. Alone at the helm, McKenzie's tabloid newspaper background clearly influenced the increasingly sensational programming. Topless darts being the textbook example.
Topless darts at the ballet.
Sasha in pink and Nancy in white. Nancy elected to throw first. She's come
on. Oh, goodness me, they are actually topless in their tutus.
Trained in the classical method, and the crowd really responding to that well. Look at that beautiful jeté.
Well, I was just slightly perturbed by the dancing with the tutus. Yeah. Nothing to do with the baps being out or they're paying darts. I was just looking at the turnout and the appalling feet.
Look at that, the crowd standing on their feet. Who can blame them?
Before that, it was just Jim Bowen. So it was like wicker furniture and darts.
Let's see now if Sasha in pink can make up for this. Don't forget.
It was the movement. They took a little run up and played with the dart. You'd get that sort of bounce. It's what we enjoyed.
It felt like a very sexualized... I mean, I loved it. It felt like a very leery era for telly. It was brilliant.
We didn't have the internet, so there was no way of, like, watching anything like porn or anything like that.
But on 90s TV, we didn't just want to see people being sexy. We wanted to learn how to do sex properly. ITV's The Good Sex Guide pulled an astounding 13 million viewers on Mondays at 10:35 p.m.
Now, if you look at my hand here, I've just put a little black blob to represent the clitoris, and my fingers represent the opening of the vagina. And here's the man's penis. Now, when the man's penis goes in, it's not rubbing against the clitoris.
But sex on 90s telly wasn't all like a saucy seaside postcard. Other shows delved into darker sexual realms. ITV's Sex Now used actors to give voice to the nation's genuine sexual thoughts.
Humphrey, a college lecturer in his late 50s, was one of many male diarists who expressed guilt and confusion about their sexuality. In Humphrey's case, this comes from the secret sexual fantasies he has and what he believes they reveal about his true attitudes to women.
See if you can guess what his fantasy is going to be. Oh, he likes arses.
Oh, there we go.
He likes arses. There we go.
I suppose it is true to say that whenever I look at any member of the female sex, I find myself wondering what it would be as an experience to see them undressed.
Humphrey was creeping me out big time. Why would you admit that on TV?
To be able to play with their bodies, to fuck.
Oh, no need for coarse language. Just to go, that's what I'm thinking everybody needs to know. Like, he's going to be banned from Waterstones now forever.
I can only describe myself as a mental rapist.
Mental rapist.
What's this footage?
As a youngster, I used to wish I had a magic gas I could release in public places and make everybody lose consciousness.
That's a crazy superpower to want, isn't it?
Then I could move among the crowd and rape the chosen females.
What the hell?
Later, rearranging their apparel so that they would never realise it had happened.
This is like Embarrassing Minds.
What a really anti-human, anti-feminine, disgusting thing to admit to. And yet I'm sure that I differ from others only in that... in the anonymity of this notebook, I'm prepared to make such a confession.
I just don't get it. No man would say that now, unless you wanted to go to prison.
The 90s frank and open attitude to sex and the swing towards political correctness meant that sex was now more inclusive. The gay community suddenly found itself on Tea Time Telly in the form of Anna Friel.
Being gay was controversial. And if you ever had two women kissing in a soap opera like in Brookside, that would cause a massive, massive backlash.
And it did. Despite attracting 6 million fascinated viewers, the scene was dropped from the weekend repeat.
We're talking millions of people at the time were still very, very uncomfortable about it and didn't want it on television and certainly didn't want it before the watershed.
But were the 90s witness to a shift in attitude to gay and lesbian relationships? Well, in 1997, the BBC's Panorama examined the matter in light of an upcoming parliamentary vote that would equalise the age of consent.
It was a very gay scene at London's Albert Hall last night. Gays and lesbians think they're on their way.
Gays, lesbians.
Tonight we examine what gay men and lesbians really, really want. Do the politicians who so recently advocated tolerance back the gay rights agenda? Does the public really want equality for gays and lesbians or not?
Vivian White does not consider himself to be quite of the same world as the gays and lesbians. He might as well be talking about... What might as well be talking about? Hottentots and Syrians.
I've got three sons, and I could forgive them anything, murder or anything. I'd be on their side. But if any one of them turned like this, I'd want to disown him.
Wow.
What harm could he actually do in this country?
Well, how can I say I'd be ashamed. I'd be ashamed that I'd brought three girls up and then him. Right? I'd just be ashamed that he would have puffed her.
In fact, I think three parts of them want burning, and I do mean that. They want burning. And I do mean that.
Now, that is very shocking. Someone saying that they should be burned. I mean, just shocking. How attitudes have changed, I think.
How many of these men playing here? And which ones do you think might be openly gay?
What is the purpose of this?
The answer, everyone in the Green Team is gay.
Everyone is gay.
Everyone.
My children would not recognise that way of talking.
It shows in quite a small period of time how dramatically things have changed.
And yet what Vivian White is doing is trying to be sympathetic to the Syrians and the Hottentots.
The age of consent would not be made equal until 2001, but the winds of change were blowing. In 1999, Channel 4 won critical acclaim and ratings of over 2 million for the drama series Queer as Folk. It's best remembered for this explicit and daring sex scene.
Remming. Yeah? Excellent.
But Queer as Folk was more inclusive than any drama had been before.
For me, Queer as Folk was a revelation at the time. I mean, if you were a closeted teenager who couldn't talk about being gay with your mates, your family, where you were brought up in a society which still basically told you you don't really want to be gay, to suddenly see on TV a programme about gay people being gay, getting on with their lives, was incredible.
Still to come, people saying things you just don't hear on TV today.
What do you say? Well, can't...
The drug culture of today and the drugs.
Terrible. He would have cut the pie of my...
How much of this would you say?
Did he really do that? Yeah! Well...
Welcome back to the 90s, when we might have thought the battle for political correctness on TV had been won. Yeah, maybe not.
Yeah, he's a good boy.
Bite that.
No.
Sorry.
It's really bad, isn't it? He's drinking it all. Look, he's got it. He's not going to let that go. Where did you discover him? And then
I up the Amazon.
For me, when Des says, "Where did you find him?" Freddie should have said, "Berlin, in a bunker." That would have been funnier than the Amazon. The Amazon doesn't really work. You haven't followed through the joke, Freddie.
He's the Humi Tingi tribe.
The Humi Tingi tribe?
Yeah. The only little fellas, you see. They're only 3'2".
Yeah.
And when they jump through the long grass, they go, "Humi Tingi."
That had been approved. And somebody in wardrobe sewed swastikas on the monkey's costume. You know, it was thought through. Somebody thought that was a good idea. It's unforgivable. It's just awful.
I think the idea that you shouldn't laugh at those things is a really wrong one. That's exactly what you should do with them, because that's how you undercut the power of those very bad things.
While the old stereotypes persisted in the 90s, a spoonful of knowing irony made them palatable. In the absurdist sitcom Father Ted, they were piled upon one another until they became hilarious.
Oh. I am Chinese, if you please. Come on, Dougal, lighten up.
I think in the 90s, irony emerged as a way of surreptitiously enjoying racist and sexist humour. Irony was a kind of pass for doing these things.
In the 90s, irony wasn't applied only to race and gender gags. Why? With a knowing look, comedians could find the funny at the expense of the working class.
I want to split up.
Oh.
I'm the only mum on the estate with a living partner. All the other mums look at me like, you know, like I'm a bit of a tit.
Poor people increasingly got a bit of a hammering. You saw that with Wayne and Waynetta Slob, and that was the beginning, if you like, of a word chav, which only became fashionable in the noughties.
But was it cruel to laugh at working class laziness?
I should be a single mother by now. It's embarrassing for the kids. They get teased by the others. You've got a daddy, you've got a daddy.
Good comedy is quite an acute social commentary. And, yeah, you know, one of the things that's gone wrong in British society is wholesale family breakdown.
Frog Mella came up to me the other day and said, "Why haven't I got a brand sister like all the other kids?" Nearly broke my heart. All the other mums have got at least one brand baby and I want one.
The writing's great, but then when it starts to get sort of, when you're sort of bringing racial stuff into it, it's like,
And for that, I need a big black man, and that ain't you, Wayne.
I'm going to give them the benefit of the doubt, say they were making a good point.
just because I like Harry Enfield and Kathy Burke, and I'd like to think they weren't sneering at poor people.
That seems to be laughing at its subject, not defending its subject.
In the 90s, we had Harry Enfield of the Slobs, and now we have Benefit Street. So we now have a reality rather than a comedy.
The 90s was a spiky time for comedy, and everywhere you turned, there was a spoof interviewer armed and ready to shoot down the egos of the famous.
West Side.
Characters like Paul Kay's Dennis Penis.
Under any circumstances, if it wasn't gratuitous and it was tastefully done, would you consider keeping your clothes on in a movie?
Who cheekily exploited celebrities' thirst for attention.
Yeah, I like that.
Sacha Baron Cohen's Ali G became so famous that his celebrity prey were eventually in on the joke. But it all began by testing the endurance of public figures keen to seem in with the kids.
Do you not think, Sir Ord, if you get caned in school, you can't concentrate as well? Because a lot of people out there say that if you're getting caned.
Well, I was caned in a time, and I've concentrated all my life.
You were that. Caned. Respect, man.
From that, it's the...
Respect.
Carolina Hearn played a character called Mrs. Merton, an old dear whose barbed interviews on her BBC Two chat show were veiled by a superficial sweetness.
You are racist, aren't you, Ben?
Yes. See, some people I like, some people I don't.
Kind of, OK.
The one thing you have to say, he was fairly honest about the way that he felt.
Hands up in this audience. Who'd like Bernard Moore if he wasn't racist?
Me.
Let me just see.
There you
now,
are.
That's a majority. You see, Bernard, we'd like you more if you weren't racist. What do you think about that?
They all get all upset about you. See, these people think they're English because they're born here. That means if a dog's born in a stable, it's a horse.
That is a pretty... cringe-making piece of telly.
Her interview with comic Bernard Manning demonstrates a generational clash. Subtle irony versus brutal honesty.
Our troops died at Dunkirk and Anzio and Arnhem and Monte Cassino.
Lots of black people died in those
not
battles.
Not at Dunkirk, my friend. Oh, no.
The Commonwealth Army was fought absolutely
oh,
through the war.
They did.
Indians,
yes,
Africans.
They did, but not for us. They fought for themselves.
But see, Richard Wilson, I mean, looking, although he really would rather he wasn't actually in the studio and making a defence about Commonwealth armies and...
There's no package at Dunkirk.
Oh. Did you just say that, Timmy?
No package at Arnhem.
The right to offend is, I think, a more important right than the right not to be offended. Because once you have a right not to be offended, you then stop free speech.
It wasn't just interviewers who were turning ironic in the 90s. Sometimes the guests were ironic as well, booked onto programmes to portray larger-than-life versions of themselves. Enter the largest liver of them all, Oliver Reed.
When I was in the army, my name was Corporal Reed 2332-4533.
What's that?
Bird shit.
Oliver Reed recognized that the timing was right for him to come back in as kind of this lad father figure because there was this celebration of just being testosterone-fueled and large in it and being over the top.
The lad father could even brighten up the ponderous late-night discussion show After Dark by treating it as a lock-in.
Not to allow your emotions to get in
there. This can't be real.
Stoking himself up. You just know that something's going to happen.
Could possibly be due
to the new drug. Oh, come on, you sound like some old chat show. And I go, well, Katie, what do you say? Well, Katie...
The drug cover of today and the drugs.
Terrible. He would have cut the pie on my head.
How much of this would you say?
Did he really do that? Yeah.
Oliver, please don't harass anyone.
As a result of Ollie's escapades, After Dark actually went dark for 20 minutes, thanks to a prank caller pretending to be a furious Channel 4 boss Michael Grade. When it returned, this happened.
I don't believe in the death penalty, but I can see that there is a strong public argument on that.
There is, and there's a passionate public
Excuse
feeling
me.
About
no,
the death
do
penalty.
Do I have
everywhere.
To? Am I expected
no,
to?
No, of course you're not expected to speak out that. Oliver, please. What? Please. It's clearly upset Kate. It's
I'm really... very sorry. Very sorry. Just had a slash killer.
Sorry, but I mean, that's aggressive, it's obnoxious. Is that something you want to visit upon someone you've invited to your program?
I think it is unacceptable.
Oliver, you've been a bore.
Sorry.
You've been a bore, and you know you have.
Sorry.
Right.
The thing is, you know, by 90 standards, all he did was give her a nice kiss on the cheek. He didn't feel her up or anything.
ITV's Richard and Judy soon learned that the lad father was as badly behaved in the morning as he was at night.
Did it brass you off that people think of you in terms of the pub, as opposed to the film? Yes, well.
Yes, well.
I can sit here just as long as you can, Oliver. I mean, we can wait all morning. No, we can't.
No, let's not make this into a competition, please. Because I know who will win.
Promise, come on. Who'll blink first? Oh, come on.
Oh, not one of them.
Yes, this is what we're talking about. Come on, Reid.
You say go, Ginny.
Right, go.
I knew I had it in me.
You're a kind
I knew
man,
I had
Oliver.
It in me.
Yeah, oh, he's bossing it. Oh, I love everything about this.
Did you smoke? Still, no. But the ravages of drink on him were painful.
Ask me a question. Don't give me the answer at the same time.
Oh, all right.
No,
thank you.
Just because you paint your face orange.
He's been saying that all morning.
Judy works very well with him. Richard is a man threatened. He's a man threatened. He's a man about to be cuckolded.
If you're going to be privileged enough to behave like a gorilla or a monkey or...
Sorry, Oliver. I didn't mean to interrupt your flow.
Stop tittering, girl.
Bangy, bang, 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 bang.
Go on.
I pulled your missus.
Him showing up in his leather jacket and demonstrating his excesses. Actually, that was kind of a before and after picture. He was like the after picture of, like, don't let this happen to you, lads.
Next.
Think of all the fun you could have instead of spending money on a dumb pack of
bags.
Welcome back. On the 11th of February 1990, Nelson Mandela was released from prison in South Africa after 27 years.
Coming towards us now is Winnie and Nelson Mandela. Nelson Mandela, tall, grey, blue-tied.
It signalled the end of the epic struggle against apartheid there. With over 500 million viewers worldwide, it was one of the most significant, unforgettable news stories ever televised. But what did this lady think?
I'm ringing to complain about the totally excessive and over-the-top coverage of the release of Nelson Mandela. I don't know who on earth thought this was momentous enough to break into the Antiques Roadshow. I assumed it was something important coming up.
This is Norton there and all those other callers, just some of the many that have called to complain about yesterday's coverage of Nelson Mandela's release.
I really like the Antiques Roadshow, and if they were just about to announce how much the picture had been worth, I'd have been a bit peeved.
None of the programme was actually lost because the BBC did continue with the broadcast later on. On the line now to express her views about that newsflash is Jess Patterson. What's your complaint? Because surely you got to see the rest of the Antiques Roadshow.
Yes, indeed I did, but I was annoyed that the Antiques Roadshow was interrupted by the speech of Nelson Mandela.
God forbid Middle England is deprived of the Antiques Roadshow. Eamon Holmes looks really hot there.
What was the point of it?
What was the point, Jess? What was the point?
Where was the balance in the news?
Well, how could you get more British than a woman phoning in from Falmouth to say that the release of Nelson Mandela has been overdone because it's interfered with the Antiques Roadshow?
I should tell you that about 95% of the calls today agree with what Jess has had to say.
So, while viewers of the Antiques Roadshow were able to express their disgust on BBC One's viewer comment show, Open Air...
Oh, my God, not Mandela again.
Another group was banned from saying anything at all on British telly. From 1988 until 1994, broadcasters in Cool Britannia were forbidden by law from airing the voices of Sinn Féin and IRA members. But it was okay to dub their words, with voice actors saying exactly the same thing.
This word, permanent.
Well, you and the people in Britain need to ask what this is about.
And so, for a BBC One observational documentary revealing all about everyday life inside Northern Ireland's Mays prison, this happened.
Because of government restrictions, some passages of this programme are voiced by actors and have been subtitled.
Here, the prison's catering officers are discussing a problem with the IRA spokesman on food.
The thing about the sausage rolls, they're getting smaller in terms of size and all that there, you know.
We're so used to growing up with that stereotype of sort of the Sinn Féin Northern Irish accent talking about we will not come to the table.
we will not be in discussion until the sausage roll situation is sorted out. You know, it's just fantastic, isn't it?
The quality's still all right. They're getting a bit small, you know.
Such dialogue is a recent innovation.
Wow. That's my immediate reaction to that. The big issue, sausage rolls are getting smaller.
There's two things you put on. The stir fry for the main meal last week and the fish cod type thing.
I would like a nice actor to be voicing my words now.
They're probably Sinn Féin leaders who thought it was a blessing that they had an actor voicing what they were saying.
In any other situation.
Well, it's obviously absurd, but it's the battle between the BBC and ITV and the government. And it was just a crazy sort of blunt instrument, but beautifully undermined in that clip.
Well, think about the sausage rolls.
That really showed up the absurdity of it.
This was Cool Britannia's coolest form of expression, pop music. But when it came to rap, however, the Americans were way cooler. But in the 90s, if you really wanted to express yourself, you had to at least try to throw down, even if it made everyone else throw up. The 8:15 from Manchester was a BBC One Saturday morning kids show in a regular feature called Rap
Tech. OK, next up on the Rap Attack, we have a crew from Cheltenham who go by the name of the Untouchables.
Kids were invited to address current issues through the medium of rap. It was based on a Swiss format called Yodel Attack. Catchy title there.
You had two chances, but you blew it. You saw teacher coming and you knew it. You said, hey, teacher, mind if I smoke? You meant it as a laugh, but it was no joke.
Okay. Oh, I love a Bristol accent.
It was actually Cheltenham.
Teacher said, stop, have you no strife? It's ruining your health and it's ruining your life. Think of all the fun you could have instead of spending money on a dump pack of fags.
Started to cry and said, OK, I'm going to stop smoking today. Now he's fit and healthy too. He stopped smoking. Can you?
He's really in time, isn't he?
Stop, have you no strife? It's ruining your health and it's ruining your life. Think of all the fun you could have instead of spending money on a dump pack of
fags.
You got to laugh, because one guy's really good at rapping, right? His timing's bang on the number. And the other guy, he's not as good with his timing.
That's so cute. And so bad at the same time.
Even Irish telly went on the Rap Attack, with Hazel O'Connor and a team of DJs on The Late Late Show, rebroadcast by Channel 4 as an afternoon show. Presenter Gay Byrne, ooh, I've had a few of them, was the first to introduce the Beatles on television, so this must have felt not the same.
Welcome, please, for Rap Against Rape.
Oh, Hazel.
It's an emergency, y'all beyond control. People are
and it's a man rapping.
As if rape was a sort of 80s thing. We gotta stamp out this hurt forever. Like Back to the Future.
The anti-rape rappers dressed as off-duty cops.
I mean, it's a bit shit, really, is it? I mean, no one wants to hear a song about rape.
Rap against rape is something we can do to try and get this message across to me and you. Yes,
while the lively backing dancers really gave their all.
But I think it's coming from a good place.
Hazel's really going for it.
Young babies, infants, toddlers, yes, even a simple child can all end up abused, can all end up defiled.
There are just fundamental rapping issues here.
It offers no defense to women in their 80s. It just don't make no sense.
I feel like it's quite a good song. I mean, but obviously it's wrong in all senses, but it makes sense. I mean, what he's saying is true.
A lot of rap has been criticised for being quite irresponsible where women's rights are concerned. But on the other hand, people enjoy the actual rapping. Here we see a kind of parallel universe where rap is concerned with morals, but none of the people doing it can rap properly.
It's the 90s. They haven't got Facebook or anything like that. They're just trying. Oh, I don't knock them.
In the 90s, when we weren't busy rapping, we were out raving. All night long. And then we'd spend the morning chilling out in front of children's TV. Keith Harris and Orville went raving mad on BBC One's Saturday morning kids show, Going Live, selling themselves as the child-friendly alternative to Sean Ryder and Bez.
Jumping on the bandwagon with a bird.
You can.
You can.
This is the 90s we know and love.
This is like a fever dream I've had. Wait, is he saying E, 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 E? Come on, come
on! Come on, come on! Come on, come on! The idea of Orville wishing he could fly, not because he's like OD'd on something that will get him high, but actually because he just doesn't have any wings.
You know, the really controversial bit about this clip is that he's got his hand up the bird's arse.
So, should we look back at TV in the 90s with a sense of humour or a sense of outrage?
I think we should look at it with a sense of outrage, because if you go, the further you go back, the sort of more OK it feels. You're like, oh, well, it was different. And actually, you look back at the 90s and you don't think it was that different.
I think the 90s was a kind of in-between time.
Kids!
We'd sort of grown up and we'd stopped doing a lot of, you know, Benny Hill material. We'd stopped doing jokes mainly about mother-in-laws and stuff like that. But we hadn't really worked out where we were going.
Now for that chat about number twos.
And that weird playground egging each other to do something sillier and sillier and more dirty and horrific and upsetting in the name of entertainment. I don't think we do that anymore.
But we're not finished there. Next time, we travel back to explore the dark side of the 1980s.
Hello, come on board.
Courtesy of a guided tour on the hazard bus.
You're lying on your back and you're sick. All that sickness runs down into your lungs and you drown.
Afternoon telly, just extraordinary.